So yes, now when with the internet, when you start thinking about something, you start surfacing the net and see what is known about that. And every now and then I was hitting the bug by Jean-Pierre, and in particular this one instance of that, so I took the subject, because if I have time, I arrive at a problem related to his work on spinners. And about spinners, again, the lecture, yes, Michael gave here, he gave me personally about 20 or 30 years ago at some meeting in some hotel during the breakfast. You don't remember that, probably, but exactly one of the things I remember that you are not supposed to understand spinners to back with them. And I felt very good because I never understood spinners and still don't understand them. But if Michael didn't understand them, well, what about the rest of us? I mean, and so just to encourage you, just make some kind of progress in this direction, and I try to convince you that we don't understand manifolds as well. So, and the geometry is we're supposed to take square root of. And this may look absurd, but strangely enough, in science, sometimes non-understanding is more essential than understanding. Yes, progress and non-understanding. And this joke made by physicists, I repeat it without truly understanding it, it's a problem in fundamental physics that when Newton discovered the law of gravitations, he solved the problem of two bodies, but he couldn't solve the problem of three bodies. And then relativity came, and now even the problem of two bodies became unsolvable. And with quantum field theory, we don't know even what vacuum is, yeah? So, and that's as good, I mean, just we, so where it goes. Now, but as a geometry, I start with something super, super, super elementary. And so here will be something about scalar curvature. Oh. And this will be about convex polyhedra. And I want to bring them together in this billiard. So what is scalar curvature? First, you have to know what is the Riemannian metric. And I take very kind of formalistic point of view. So the Riemannian metric is just positive definite quadratic form on a manifold. And everything will be local, just opposite to, this is what they say lecture, but Michael, I want to be really very local, and the question will be globalized kind of rather unexpectedly. So the metric is just at every, it's a field of quadratic functions on a space. So to each x, we assign a quadratic function f on the tangent space, which is, in the case of Euclidean space, the same space. Yeah. So just in the space of quadratic function. Quadratic meaning it's quadratic on every line and smooth. Yeah, it's not just homogeneous, but quadratic. And of course, you can say, hi, it's just family of functions. You can say if it's Euclidean space, domain of the Euclidean space, you just have so many functions. Yes, real valued functions, but the point of course they transform differently, right? When you change coordinate, they transform differently. Now, what is scalar curvature? And then there is a fact of algebra that there is a unique up to scaling differential operator of second order from the space of Riemannian metric to real numbers or to functions. Yeah, so this is a Riemannian metric to functions from your manifold, say manifold will be V. Yeah. From functions here, it's a second order differential operator, which is linear in the second derivatives, invariant under the action of diffeomorphisms. And there is a unique such operator up to scaling. So there is a question how you normalize it. Yeah? And the normalization is that if you take unit, so normalization for two sphere is that for two sphere it equals two, because two sphere. It's for unit two sphere, it's for that reason it's two. And then it's additive. When you multiply to manifolds, say, surfaces, yeah, then it is this additive, it adds up. And essentially all you have to know. It's uniquely determined by that. So you don't have, so you understand, of course, nothing of that. Yeah, you say this verse and that's it. Of course, it's also defined in a, not metric doesn't have to be positive definite, but then it's not so interesting. So you have that. Now, yes, to make some sense of that again, Riemannian manifold and curvature is a tricky point, but if it's a surface, it's just twice Gaussian curvature. And if you have a general hypersurface, so what you do in high dimensional space, you have hypersurface. And so what you do, you intersect it with three dimensional planes kind of normal to this. You have a surface now, piece of a surface everywhere. In this surface, there is Gaussian curvature and average of all this. over all the sections. So at every point, it's now defined geometrically. That's enough for purposes I want to discuss. It's this concept of scalar curvature already sophisticated enough. Now I want to formulate a theorem in a kind of a proper. We want to understand the meaning of that.
Yeah.
We want to understand if it has some geometric meaning. And for geometers, meaning means you have to throw away derivatives. You have to express in the language there will be no derivatives. It's too complicated. Yeah. It must be something more elementary. And one way to think before I start formulating a theorem, I just say how we can kind of, before it means to throw away derivatives. Yeah. And you can say, imagine your metric is only continuous. It's not smooth. So it's, or then can you say something if this curvature makes sense? In particular, if some condition on curvature you study, and the condition may be, say, scalar curvature, people either study it, say, positive or say negative, or it may be, of course, any constant inside, but it has geometric meaning. Before you start thinking about this meaning, you want to say if it is this condition stable under limits which are only uniform, not respecting derivatives. And motivation for that, at least for me, comes from how it was developing in the symplectic geometry. And there is some kind of wave similarity when it was a question raised by Eliasberg, if symplectic diffeomorphisms invariant being symplectic under uniform limits, and this was extending the work of Poincaré, he eventually proved they are stable. And that was the starting point of the big development in symplectic geometry in the modern time after Poincaré. There were two kind of big steps, kind of, was on one hand by Eliasberg and then by Rabinowitz, who actually proven equivalent results in different language. And then there was all this development followed that. But in the scalar curvature case, it seems that my feeling is there is a similar kind of theory, but it's never went as far as it should. And so I want to, and the reason is because we have to modify, I think, the concept of manifold. That's the problem with this. And so, so this is the question we want to ask. And then you know that this is out of questions. Because if a dimension bigger than 2, there is so-called log-hump. I'm always confused about spelling. In which H and K, I think it's, is this right? Right? Correct, yeah. Log-hump H principle, who proven that uniform limits completely destroy this condition. So any metric can be approximated by metrics of negative curvature, scalar curvature, or even negative Ricci curvature. So there is no geometric message in negativity of curvature. But for positive curvature, it's different. And this is what I rather recently approved, that it is stable under the limits. So the space of metric of positive curvature or bounded by any constant is stable under uniform limits, which means semi-continuity, of course, with that. Which means that there must be geometric message. Of course, it was known before. There were some results, but they were of slightly different kind. Now, and just the easiest case of that, which I wrote a while ago, was based, and I want to formulate some very, very nice result by LaRule. I think I'm not certain about spelling. That was his thesis under Blaine Lawson. And the kind of.
I think it's 2L on the beginning.
It's 2L beginning, maybe, yeah. Who was Blaine Lawson's student at the time, his thesis? Who has proven very simple looking theorem. And it is as follows. So you have a sphere, and you have a standard metric, and you have some other metric G. And such that this metric is strictly greater than that. And for Riemannian metric, because the square root has not been taken, inequality makes sense. Yeah. You know, even when you take square root and you go to complex geometry, I mean, fun starts when again there is positivity on the high level, right? Complex numbers have some positivity, right? Built into them. And so positivity never disappears. Yeah? You try to kill it and then comes in a new kind of guy. After all, intersection is always positive between complex manifolds. Yeah? And there are many kind of generations. So imagine I have that. And then the theorem says that scalar curvature, there is a point S in the sphere such that, this was standard metric and this another metric, there will be points in the sphere such that the scalar curvature of G at this point X will be less or equal than scalar curvature of G naught at this point X. So when you enlarge the metric, at least at some point scalar curvature must go down. And this is a kind of simple looking result, even when this metric G comes from this example of hypersurface, just a hypersurface around that. There is no simple proof. It's for very simple, but not elementary. And it depends heavily on Dirac operator. You have to produce particular vector bundle, take twisted Dirac operator, compute some curvature, tie, and the proof takes one line, if you do it right. But and there is no kind of any other way to prove it. And I want to indicate, it has to do something with global result about spheres. There is no topology involved. There is extra topological point which one can do. And of course, it's a better formulate maybe in this more stable way in which it's needed. Namely, it's better to say it this way. Have a sphere cross torus flat, topological torus, and this maps to the sphere. And here there is a metric G. And here is metric G naught. And if this map is distance decreasing, then this metric must have some way curvature greater than that of the sphere. Smaller than that of the sphere, I'm sorry. The bigger the space, the smaller the curvature. Right? And so you can add the torus. And so topology is not as any manifold, yeah? But it might be topologically torus. So topology is kind of hidden, but it's very elementary topology, no characteristic classes, nothing like that. So just index theorem appears in a very kind of hidden way, and it's very unclear why it is there at all. So, but now what it has to do with this limit question, and then this theorem can be combined with another kind of idea we used in scalar curvature, which was brought, yes. So Dirac operator was brought there by Knorowitz. But in fact, Dirac never had idea of this operator. It was your operator, right? Dirac has only one on flat space, yeah? You know, in the indefinite metric.
Yeah, but Knorowitz,
yeah.
The people in relativity theory knew how to extend it to curved space
at the time, of course. They knew it at that time, yeah? Because, another idea was about the idea of minimal surface and scalar curvature. Let me explain this in 2 words. So in this Lichnerovitz idea, Lichnerovitz approach, essentially the Bochner formula. Because there are all these things, operator, elliptic, ta-ta-ta-ta, but they would be completely kind of vacuous if not for some particular kind of formula and some identity and positivity of some expression, right? And so the same for minimal surfaces, and the first instance made by Shen Yao, and I don't know, I guess it was a similar thing done by physicists, but unrigorously. That if you have a surface, a minimal surface inside of three-dimensional Riemannian manifold, it's a minimal surface, and you consider it and push the binomial field and see what will be the second derivative of the area, because it's minimal by definition, the first definition of area is zero, and the second derivative would be just integral of the Gaussian curvature plus or minus integral of the ambient scalar curvature. And this is this formula. This is similar to the Bochner formula. I want to say that in fact that, and once you know that, it follows that if manifold, ambient manifold, have positive scalar curvature, this surface must be sphere. It cannot be anything else because Gauss-Bonnet theorem prevents you from doing that. And then it immediately shows that, for example, if you have torus, three-dimensional torus, it cannot have metric of positive scalar curvature because you have minimal surfaces which will be tori or higher genus, and you have contradiction. Right? So this is another point. And now the two things, but then there are kind of some elaboration of this idea. Now I want to say the first thing which I knew about that was that if you have metric of constant curvature, so you have manifold and you have G naught of constant curvature, then scalar curvature was semi-continuous at this point. So if it wasn't constant curvature, you can't approximate it uniformly by metrics which have more positive curvature. All nearby metrics may have only smaller curvature. And the point was, consider not so much minimal surfaces that around this point, constant curvature, but consider these spheres around them. And if you perturb a little bit the metric, they are not minimal, but as minimal bubbles, they remain stable. They kind of disappear, like for the same reason, essentially, as minimal surface in the torus, this equator is stable. And therefore, you have this kind of minimal bubble, and similar argument applies. And then you can show that not this sphere themselves around them, but this time circle would have scalar curvature greater than the sphere. And therefore, it cannot. So if you gain some positive curvature here, it will be gained here, and you have contradiction with the rule. So you can derive this local result, which is just limited near, obviously near small point, but from this rather global thing, we shoot the whole thing of index theorem and full kind of power of index theorem, right? And because here there is a circle, a torus, you need not just usual index theorem, but index theorem for families. So it's really the whole thing amazingly goes to this local stuff. And then, yes, for many years I just couldn't generalize for general thing, and eventually I kind of managed to do that, and then came from completely different kind of way of thinking, which I have actually was not thinking about that. And now, let's look at the second part of that. So that's about billiards and convex polyhedra. So I want to understand convex polyhedra. And so I just, as I said, understanding means we just to show we don't understand it. Right, so we want to show a subject we don't understand. So one question is somewhat amusing, because I remember when I thought about that, I found something on the net, and I thought it was obvious, and so didn't register it. But then later on, I realized my obvious wasn't correct. And the statement is that if you consider all polyhedra, where all dihedral angles bounded from above, so they're all sufficiently acute, then there are only finitely many combinatorial types. For convex polygons, clear, because the sum of angles, you know, the more you add, the sum grows. And also, it's easy to see that if you have really acute angles, so less than pi over 2, there might be simplices. If you allow pi over 2, only have products of simplices. But then, it's not so clear. At least, I couldn't find, I asked all people around, and nobody knows that, even people who wrote textbooks on that, but I remember it was mentioned in some survey, and I couldn't find it anymore. But this is not exactly, yes, this is a kind of relevant issue, but another property which you want to know anyway, what are possible angles, dihedral angles of this polyhedra? And then in this respect, there is one result, very simple, and just immediately raises the question. Is for simplices, just for triangles, of course, rather obvious, but already for two simplices, simple but non-trivial. Is that if you have two simplices and corresponding dihedral angle in one greater than another, in fact the two are congruent, or yes, homothetic. You cannot enlarge the angles. And this is, as we shall see, exactly the same phenomenon, right? The side of the same phenomenon, that you cannot enlarge scalar curvature of the sphere. And so this is what I want to explain. And this is a very old result. It's due to Kirschbaum theorem. It's called Kirschbaum theorem, where it's lemma kind of. It's kind of, the proof is kind of algebraic. Yeah, it's just positivity of a scalar product. It's not just seen geometrically, yeah, because here, you just sum of angles like that, and then you see it. And here it's, well, one line proof, but it's kind of, you have to write some simple formula to do it. By the way, I can't just count this. There is some kind of, well, maybe much development is shared to that in different direction. Okay, so, and for example, in particular, I don't know for what are other polyhedra when the same remains true. I take a polyhedron, and I imagine I can deform it such that combinatorial type doesn't change, but all the dihedral angles go up. Is it, although if it's possible, yeah, except for moving some faces in parallel one to another. Say for cubes, yeah, it also true for product of simplices. The same result, for example, so I make modify square like that, but that's all. And the same high dimensions. But then my next question was, okay, this is a convex theory, it's too kind of too rigid, and you want to say something more geometric and allow curved linear polyhedra. And curved linear the point, of course, naively you think that, so here you say, I cannot make angles bigger or angles smaller, they sound the same. And so it's emphasized when I can make angles smaller, or rather when I cannot make them smaller. And it's clear that if I allow just convex bending, yeah, so I have a something polyhedra, but face a convex, then angles may only become bigger. How much this is true in high dimensions? And convexity is, again, is to a rigid condition. What I want to say is mean curvature convexity. Which means my faces must have positive mean curvature. And positive mean curvature in this direction means when I push it inside, it getting area goes down. And when I push outside, it goes up. In smooth category, this is the same. But in the more in situation I want to go, it may be not a priori the same. Yeah, the fact that it goes down here doesn't mean abstractly it goes up there. But for a smooth surface, it's like that. And so the question is now, is as follows. So I have a polyhedron in three spaces, in high dimensional space, three spaces, yeah, we know slightly better. If you can deform it, so keeping this mean causativity of the faces, so the angles become smaller. And conjecturally, for most polyhedra, if never, it's possible. It just, if you do that, it's just the only thing is parallel translation. And, well, sometimes you can prove, sometimes not, and then by actually this theorem about parallel spinors may enter, of Jean-Pierre. So the case when I can handle is kind of almost, yeah, is just a rectangular cube. And this will be relevant to our problem. If it is a cube, what I can prove that you cannot deform it in such a way. Namely, whenever you make them faces with positive curvature, some of the angles will go up. But I cannot prove that the extremal configuration necessarily flat. That's the usual thing. And this is exactly where you need this thing about parallel. Think and just we have to modify the concept of Dirac operator, I guess, and spinner. So, how it goes? And again, just even this kind of result, the proof depends on the use of the Dirac operator. Maybe in this case you can use because there is actually recently there was some paper by Lochamp when she. That's something with minimal surfaces, but I think it's questionable if you know what you think about his work, if it's solid or not.
I think, it, as far as I understand, it's solid.
It's solid by now, yeah?
Well, I guess he's fighting with some people there, but I guess we shouldn't go into those details here.
Yeah, no, but the question is, I read the paper, I don't quite understand them. So I can't watch for them, yeah, and then kind of unpublish. But so there may be alternative, yes, way to handle that with minimal surfaces, but Dirac operator is applies here. And then, so what we know, that's actually this follows from a Kamp theorem, but was known before, that if you have a torus and torus, then this was conjectured by Geroch, and I wonder exactly what was his motivation, and then solved in dimension below 7 by minimal surface by Diao and Schoen. And apparently with the same method now by Lochamp, but in between, with Blaine Lawson proven for all dimensions using twisted Dirac operator. So it admits no metric of positive scalar curvature. No metric G with scalar curvature which is positive. And actually, if it is zero, then it is flat, and this actually rigidity is tricky in what I'm going to say. So if you have such a creature with positive mean curvature on faces, you may start reflecting it. And when you reflect it, it kind of develops, and you can close it up and become a torus. And then it's not hard to show, and this again was shown with Blaine Lawson, we proved it, that you can smooth the angles and then these three little points with the corners, it will have positive scalar curvature. If this mean curvature was at some point strictly positive, it will be strictly positive mean curvature. But if it was minimal surfaces, we're not quite clear. Yeah. And then we will have some kind of singular objects with abstractly with positive scalar curvature or non-negative scalar curvature to which usual techniques don't apply. At least, and then it is, I come to that later, how we can handle that. So this kind of a thing after reflection become like a torus, and you can smooth it in this category, you can apply either of the technique, either scalar, either minimum surfaces if they work, or Dirac operator, twisted Dirac operator. And then this is a point about what you can say billiard. Because if you think what happens, how it looks inside of this, so you reflect it and close it up, and you kind of think about this is a torus and it being fundamental domain in the torus. And look at minimal surface in the torus. So how do you look here? And this will be a tremendous mess. Yeah, it will be look a little bit like orbits of a billiard, and in dimension one, it will be billiard. And it's even more tricky for Dirac operator, because the boundary condition here is not the one which can be handled by Dirac, right? So you upset on the torus, we use usually either we use family of twisted with a family of flat bundle Dirac or with some non-flat bundle. And so it's in a big space, something happens. And so what you see here is extremely tricky, it becomes extremely condensed picture. And so what is this can be built there. And so I will explain later how probably you can understand this. Yeah. And then again, I say you'll have to modify concept of manifold. Now, how this can be used, what it has to do with our original question. So now let me come back to that. So we want to understand the matrix. So it's the theorem which I want to prove. On this side, is that if I have a Riemannian manifold, and I have family of metric such that their scalar curvatures are greater equal some function on V, then and they this metric uniformly converges to G, then the same is true for this metric. So a scalar curvature at every point V will satisfy the same condition. Right. So if scalar curvature were greater than something on all these metrics, the same inequality will be true for the limit. So it's semi-continuous, I keep forgetting from up or below. It's in principle, I think, impossible to remember. So what has to do with this? Yeah? So you want to characterize the sign of the curvature in terms of something inside, and this must be kind of on the middle size, and just for that remind you how you do it for usual curvature. And for usual curvature, one of the way to characterize it, and was kind of implicit in the work by Robert, that it is the sum of angles of the triangles. Yeah. And so, in particular, positive curvature in dimension 2 characterized, but if we take any such triangle, the angles will have tendency to be bigger than the angles in the flat case. And for negative smaller, but negative doesn't have extension. And here, so what you want to do, just you combine this Euclidean picture with Riemannian one, and you say, aha, positive scalar curvature is characterized by the fact that whenever you take inside this kind of domain, and in fact, what is? You can prove it from a larger class of domain, this cubical domain. It might be cubical only in combinatorial sense. It doesn't have to be topologically cubical. It's formally cubical domain. And if all faces have positive mean curvature, then you cannot have all angles less than pi over 2. And that would be abstract characterization of positive scalar curvature. And this makes sense. You don't need much regularity of the space because you can define positive mean curvature, as I said. You don't need any regularity of the metric. You don't have to say the word curvature. It's just how it behaves on the inside or outside variation of area. So you have the notion of area. But here, this subtle point. So what you call kind of inside and outside variation are the same. And so it's one of the issues which was occupying me. What are singular spaces and this of say positive or whatever scalar curvature. And when you arrive at this question, I guess the answer is they are not spaces in the usual sense. Yeah. And this way you need to change concept of space. However, so what you can do here, still in this kind of naive setting, the point is that if you have a point of negative curvature, scalar curvature, if there is such a point of negative scalar curvature, then around it always there is such a cube. You can surround it by a cube where all faces will have positive mean curvature and all angles will be smaller than pi over 2. And this little algebra you can just construct it using a particular frame. And then if you could approximate by positive curvature, you arrive at the contradiction with the previous thing, right? So what goes into that, just one little remark. So inside of this, you need some geometric measure theory, right? Because this construction require construction of surface of positive mean curvature, which is not completely as simple as you may think. And just let me give an instance of that of some different nature, where this problem enters in here in a slightly bigger form. Imagine you take Euclidean space, and you just perturb this metric a little bit in some uniform topology. And then the statement, the first Euclidean space can be exhausted by balls with bounded with convex boundaries. And by geometric measure theory, it follows you can now, if it was small perturbation, with respect to new metric, you still can exhaust it by similar shapes of positive mean curvature. And there is no elementary proof of that. You have to go through whole, at least for all I know, geometric measure theory, construct them, use regularity theorem of Almgren and Allard to show the really smooth surfaces of positive mean curvature. And this is very strange. This looks very soft question. So yes, exhausted by these positive convexes looking surfaces. And there is no simple proof. And the same thing enters here, and the interesting class of problem appears that you have now this kind of polyhedra, which builds where boundaries are the minimum surfaces or the kind of so bubble of constant curvature, and you have prescribed angles when they meet, for example, 90 degree angles, right? And this is obtained by consecutively solving the plateau problem. So first you have something like that, minimal surfaces, then you take minimal surfaces like that, then you have minimal surface here, but then there are singularities at the corners. And it is, the singularity of the boundary value problem in the corners may be enormously unpleasant, right? When the corner getting deeper and deeper, it becomes horrible, horrible mess, and even in the linear equation, for Laplace equation, it's not understood. Actually, I spoke to some expert on that, who wrote measure two volumes on that, and they very complicated estimate. I'm asking, why this kind of estimate? Why not in this case? Well, it's unknown. All simple cases are unknown. And they're known to be messy, but the sharp result in simple terms are unknown. However, in this situation, you can bypass them. For some reason, you can go around them. And this will go there. And now a few words reminding about why I'm saying it's something wrong with our space and manifolds. So it seems that all these singularities, which either appear in minimal surfaces, or they suggest that you have to have spaces which have nothing regular in them. They might be singular spaces and still have scalar curvature. And when you start doing that, it becomes kind of very unpleasant to prove anything. And then if you hope it will work, you will have to have a full geometric measure theory there, which is conceivable. But then you have to have Dirac operator, which looks kind of very unlikely, to have it on two singular spaces. And the space may be extremely singular. Example, you can produce super, fractal spaces, which in some sense of positive curvature. And Dirac operator should be there at least enough to say it's under some conditions possible and some possible. And then there is an idea, which I think must be elaborated and due to Maxim, yeah? And I don't know what Maxim now can comment on that, is that how we can think about manifolds. And one of them is to say that manifold is a contravariant functor from the category of graphs to category of measure spaces, right? And this, I think, is extremely nice way to think about manifolds, right? It looks
like
exactly. This was applicable. Now I want to indicate kind of Ricci curvature. It's related to Ricci curvature. But the point, again, is I want to say just for the audience, what Maxim knows that. So what's so good to say it, yeah? When you say these words, right? So this being functor contains kind of a volume of complicated green type formulas, right? You write all the integral formulas and they own this word contravariant functor. It's an extremely concise way. So the whole book, yeah, you just read a book, 100 formulas, and you can say, aha, all they say the certain thing is functorial. And so what is this functor? And this functor for manifolds is quite simple. When you have a graph, and a graph with length being assigned, and here is the Riemannian manifold, you assign the space of maps there with a Wiener measure. And that's the object. And this knows all information about Laplace operator there. All green functional fundamental solution, ta da da. And then because Wiener measure is defined here perfectly in this situation, it's a kind of not conditional measure, but honest measure, it's also the functoriality. And now what about Dirac operator? So in this thing, I think only half of the Dirac operator is defined. You cannot quite say what Dirac operator is, but you can have kind of a bound, a lower upper bound on this operator. And the point is when you map a graph, this is my speculation, this pure speculation may be not true. When you have a graph going there, you can pull back connection and the Dirac defined along this graph, even if it's discontinuous. And at this vertices, you know, there is something, this is kind of bundle, tangent bundle, but because it's at the vertices, you know, this correspond to these edges. And so you can incorporate in this picture the Dirac operator, or rather connection and therefore spinners. And this requires less regularity. It's partly integrated. The point is that you already integrated connection, so you don't need this regularity. It's already kind of in there. But again, I don't know if and then, interestingly enough, at this point, you also can incorporate information about minimal surfaces. And they come together because when you have hypersurfaces there, they control by how graph intersects these hypersurfaces. So hypersurfaces will be reflected by some kind of points in there, in this family. And I guess, I kind of dream, you can completely forget about manifold, single and unsingle, and develop this kind of theory, and then everything becomes kind of very nice, and there will be no manifolds. So my general remark, manifolds is, Michael mentioned, we are, in I think the way we know it, we invented by Hermann Weyl about 70 years ago. It's a long time, I mean. 100 years ago. It's a long time. It's time to have something new. Hermann Weyl. Main foundation of himself. So it's time to invent something new. I mean, and the basis, I believe, there, what is developed, in both cases, is kind of Dirac and Bochner formulas. And for minimal surface, also, this kind of, they're purely positive equation. You see, there's nothing square root there. Yeah? It's completely hidden. And they must be part of a bigger body of some, if you have this algebra, and somehow it will be unraveled in this kind of functorial picture. But this is kind of a dream, and I wrote an article that tried to give more justification of that, but of course I don't know. Yeah.
Il y a des questions, other questions?
Misha, how do you make sense with the condition that the manifold is spin in this context?
Well, you see, in many cases, you don't need spin. Spin being suppressed, yeah. Of course, for the Lichnerowitz type theorem, you need spin. But in this geometric theorem, spin is irrelevant. It's only just a problem. It's only, we know it's, if Locam is true, it's unneeded.
So Dirac doesn't operate on the spinner field?
It it will be not a Dirac operator. It will be something. It will be not an operator. Yeah, it's something which remains of Dirac in this picture. It will be less than Dirac, but sufficient to encode some of the geometry of the space. But this is my understanding, yeah. So about spin, of course, it's a big issue, yeah. And you see all the time this issue appears, code dimension two kind of play a special role here. So I must say I don't know the answer. To be honest, the most honest answer. That I don't know it, yeah. But partly maybe it is, but the way I see it's not the Dirac. And the question, technical question is, what is behavior of the spectrum of Dirac under this weak limits of matrix? And this we have to understand. So what remains of Dirac under this weak limits?
When you spoke about the angles, somehow you jumped directly from sectional curvature characterization to the scalar curvature characterization, leaving out Ricci curvature as an intermediate step.
That's correct.
But somehow one would maybe think that if you look at this for Ricci curvature, it might be easier, in particular, in terms of the recent developments in terms of transportation inequalities and stochastic processes, which might also be behind this.
Now I can make the general kind of remark why I emphasize scalar curvature. Yes, from perspective, I take that kind of the thing you want. You have maximally soft environment like clouds, and still to find some structure in it. If you lay some subject rigid, like Ricci curvature, sectional curvature, well, you know there is a lot of structure there. I mean, it's not so much surprise to add more and more. But here, in scalar curvature, it's absolutely like topology, almost amorphous. There is nothing. Or like symplectic structure, it's very, very soft. And then amazingly hit the wall. And then you hit it, something remarkable happens. In one instance, of course, for many folds. Topology is very softish. Actually, originally, this was kind of what Poincaré. People were kind of saying, what will you do? It's such a kind of flabby thing. Why to do this mathematics? But then condense and become a weather rigid. And then what happened with dimension 4. And then another instance, symplectic topology. And now I think it's that. So the whole point, you start from something extremely soft, and then must condense to something rigid. And Ricci curvature, I'm not against it, but it's a different kind of mathematics. It's already very structural. And there are relations, of course. Yeah, I think the Ricci flow equation has something to do with that. In some cases, you can do with that. Ricci curvature does enter, but not in a very, again, in this setting. It's exactly as Maxim said. Ricci curvature is seen in this picture, in this functorial picture. Right? And this transportation will measure whatever implicit there. But not by itself. This I use sectional curvature only as motivation, yeah, just. Because many statements from there can be transported to scalar curvature, sometimes conjecturally, sometimes we can prove them. And but Ricci curvature, I guess, again, I can discuss it, but this is actually, first I thought about Ricci curvature in this context before I turned to scalar curvature.
This is really a comment. I learned something from a physicist recently which I found very interesting. It has to do with combinatorial polyhedra and Dirac operator.
Yeah.
If you try to set up, for example, a triangulation of manifold and then imagine it getting smaller, finer and finer, and they get to a smooth limit, then of course, if you try to set up this up so that you get to the index of the Dirac operator in the end, only succeed if you put the index in at the beginning, because for finite systems the index is always fixed. So it was always a mystery to me how you could get to from a combinatorial picture to a. But the physicist didn't have any answer. For a physicist, if you take a combinatorial structure, you can write down the Dirac operator formally and write down a spectrum, and then what they should look at for physicists is not the zero eigenvalues, but what they call the low lying eigenvalues and the high eigenvalues. And this is, of course, a very vague notion. And the idea is that when you make a refinement, then the low-lying eigenvalues get closer and closer to zero, and the other eigenvalues stay in the sky. And this way, the answer is not to look at the zero eigenvalue for combinatorics, only to look at small eigenvalues, whatever this means. Now, of course, the scalar curvature enters in precisely in estimates to do with the zero eigenvalues. So that makes some kind of link with this.
Of course, this kind of thing. Yeah, but yes, my point is that to try to move toward the direction of what Maxim suggested from concept of point space. It's another point space. Actually, even metric spaces, we as well think as functors from very simple category, as category of two-point space or something. And that gives you certain perspective, and also bypass singularities. Because Maxim has another occasion how to bypass singularities in Poisson structures. By certain kind of algebraization, and the same happens in symplectic geometry. If you relax situation, you can bypass singularity, but you have to keep algebra with you, but in a different world. Algebra is always there, the identities are always there, but how you embody them should change. But how, I don't know.
I just want to comment a bit on this, because this graphs appeared as a limit of surfaces, kind of string theory, and string theory target space would be very singular, so it's kind of great in closed spaces.
Yes, possibly. Yeah, this I don't understand. This you may understand, I don't. Yeah.
J'ai une question. Si on considère un facteur contravariant sur la catégorie des graphes, est-ce qu'on peut donner des conditions, ou rêver de donner des conditions nécessaires et suffisantes pour que ce facteur soit représentable par une variété?
Non, je vais vous demander, Maxime.
Ah. D'autres questions, dans un prochain.